Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. From our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum in New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. From Mid-City to Metairie, from the French Quarter to the gates of Disneyland, Ralph Brennan offers an authentic taste of New Orleans to hungry diners everywhere. Ralph comes by his restaurateur chops, honestly, as a descendant of Owen Brennan, original patriarch of the Brennan's clan. On this week's Louisiana Eats, Ralph tells the story of growing up in the family business and how he came to save the famous dining establishment where it all began, the iconic Brennan's Restaurant on Royal Street in New Orleans' historic French Quarter. Then, new children's book author Simone Rathe joins us with the rollicking tale of 10 tiny turtles who call Brennan's courtyard home. And Ralph Brennan's executive vice president, Charlee Williamson, shares the amazing story of how computer-generated analytics helped turn around Ralph Brennan's Disneyland Jazz Kitchen in California, which helped keep the whole operation afloat when the entire city nearly drowned during Hurricane Katrina. Get ready to flambe the bananas Foster on this week's Louisiana Eats. Ralph Brennan is one of the most prolific members of the Brennan's clan. His restaurant empire includes Ralph's on the Park, the Redfish Grill, Cafe B, Cafe Noma, the Napoleon House, and the Jazz Kitchen at Disneyland in Anaheim, California. Ralph wasn't looking for another restaurant opportunity, but when the original establishment bearing the family's name became available in 2013, Ralph knew he had to do something to save the iconic Brennan's Restaurant. Ralph, why are we sitting here on Royal Street today?
How much time do you have?
As much as you do.
I'm sitting here on Royal Street with you because it's where my family started. You know, they started with the Absin House on Bourbon Street, moved across the street to the Vieux Carré Restaurant, put the Brennan name on that, called it Brennan's Vieux Carré. That's where breakfast at Brennan's started. But it really took off at this Royal Street location. They acquired the lease on the building in 1955, and the restaurant opened in 1956. And that's where, really, I think breakfast at Brennan's became famous. And in a sense, I think, you know, the earlier generation of my family created a meal period in that breakfast meal period, because it's not your traditional scrambled eggs, grits, and bacon.
Describe what breakfast at Brennan's means to you.
It's a multi-hour, long meal that starts with traditional New Orleans ingredients like turtle soup and egg sardou, and finishes with like bananas Foster. But I think one of the most important things that no one typically has at breakfast is some sort of alcoholic beverage. It could start with a milk punch, perhaps, or a glass of wine. And I think that adds an extra dimension to the meal period.
Give me some of your iconic landmarks, you know, of what coming here to Royal Street meant to you.
Well, what often happened when I was very young is that I was the right age for my aunts Ella and Adelaide to take me on weekends. And my parents back then were probably glad to give me up for the weekend so they could have a little peace and quiet. But I would spend time with them. They lived with my grandparents up on Eleanor Street. So I'd go over there, and then we'd come downtown, and the tradition was to go to a movie, and then they actually would take me to Woolworths. Now I'm about 7 or 8 years old when this is all happening, and they'd buy me a toy or something to play with, because we'd come back over. I'm going to say we came back over to the restaurant at 4 o'clock, and they would go to work, and then I would play. And so my memories of this building at that age were a playground. I had the free run from all the way in the attic in the third floor, all the way downstairs to the kitchen, out to the wine cellar in the back. And I, you know, I used to run around and play here and, you know, interact with the staff and try not to get in any trouble. And then, you know, about 8:30 or so, we'd sit down for dinner. And I'd have dinner with my aunts and have a wonderful evening, then go back home to my grandparents' house and then get up the next morning. My grandmother would make breakfast and I'd spend some time with them because my aunts tended to sleep in a little bit.
Yeah, your two aunts, they're something else.
They really were. Adelaide especially. I was very close with her, close with Ella also. But I had a lot of fun with Aunt Adelaide.
Well, all of us who grew up in New Orleans have memories of dining in restaurants. So you're a little boy, 7, 8 years old. What do you order for dinner at Brennan's?
I used to order steak Diane. That was my favorite dish. I would order that, and they also had vichyssoise. And I grew up on vichyssoise, and my mother used to tell the story about a train trip that we took to St. Louis because her brother lived in St. Louis, and we went up once to visit. And while we're on the train, we go to the dining car, and of course I asked for vichyssoise. They didn't have anything like vichyssoise on the train, so she laughed at me for that. But that's kind of what I grew up on, was vichyssoise and then steak Diane. And although I loved Bananas Foster, my favorite was Crepes Fitzgerald, the strawberries. I've always loved strawberries, so that was the perfect dessert for me. And as I was growing up, too, I found a refrigerator where it was all stored, and I'd often just eat it cold.
So you knew all the nooks and crannies here.
As I said, I had a free run of the building, and one of my favorite places was the wine cellar, and the sommelier at the time would let me in, and you know, I'd go look around and look at all the bottles and the labels, and had a lot of fun.
Well, when you look at the Brennan's family history, my goodness, you know, you're talking about, oh, the other restaurateurs, and we're all so close in the community. Well, my goodness, Ralph, you're related to a huge percentage of them, aren't you?
Well, when you look at the total number of restaurants, we probably do have a pretty high percentage.
It's so wonderful that you recognize that someone else with another name might suddenly own this iconic pink building. And that, I guess, is one of the things that originally spurred you into action.
Well, sort of. But what happened is I had someone come to me at a social event and say, you need to talk to your cousin Ted. He needs some help. And so I reached out to Ted. We had lunch at the Rib Room. And had a second lunch at the Rib Room. And, you know, I tried to begin a dialogue to try to help them in any way. I had no interest in Brennan's. You know, they'd had it for roughly 40 years and seemed to be doing pretty well until the last few years. And we talked for almost 2 years off and on. And then there came a point where it became obvious that they were going to lose the restaurant. And that's when I stepped in and said, look, I need to do something here to try to keep it in the family, and it appeared no other family members were that interested. So, you know, Terry White was looking at it also, and, you know, Terry knew of my interest, I knew of his interest, and so we decided it would be best to form a partnership, and that's what we did.
So you formed this partnership, and you acquired the building, but the building didn't have a name for a long time because the name didn't go along with the building. So how did it feel when that must have been a very interesting day? Because once again, it took another trip to court to get the rights to your own last name here on Royal Street.
Yes, we did buy the building in May of 2013. And it really wasn't until July of 14 that we were able to acquire the name through the bankruptcy court. We had plan B and C and hoped that we would never have to use them because there was nothing better than to get the Brennan name and get it back on the building. And we did have several appearances in court, and finally we were able to get it. And it was a very emotional day for me because, I mean, I knew that was that really completed the circle, and we were able to bring, you know, we'd be bringing Brennan's back. We were well along in the renovation. We had all these great ideas that we were executing, but it would have been something different without the name.
It sure would have been. Is it's interesting to me too that part of what you acquired were the recipes. You can't copyright a recipe. So I'm not even quite sure how you own a recipe. So how did the recipes go along with the name?
Well, they really didn't. The court said we could have the recipes, but no one gave us any recipes. What we really got was a key to the door, and that's about it. That's about it. You know, we were able to get the logo, the rooster, things like that, but really no recipes came along with it. So what we've used, I've gone back to both of the cookbooks. There was the original cookbook that Ella and the family wrote in 19, I believe it was beginning around 1960. And then Ted and Ellen, Pip and Jimmy, they all wrote a cookbook. I forget the publication date, but within the last 10 or 15 years. So we've used both of those books to look at the recipes. And when we've done some research online, and, but we kind of knew what the dishes look like. You know, this is a very special place to me. It's a very special place to my family. And as I said earlier, I'm really starting to recognize how special it is to the rest of the community. And so that's, it's humbling, but it also scares the hell out of me. Because, you know, people will be coming back and you know, we're going to have to live up to all of their expectations. And that'll be quite a challenge, but I think we're up to the task. And, you know, I just hope that it continues for another generation or two. And I don't know if I can worry about it after that. But
you were born for this job, Mr. Brennan. Don't worry.
Well, I hope so. I hope so. You know, it's a place I grew up. I have very, very fond memories of being here as a child. And one memory I'll tell you about is a microphone in front of me just like this. There was a lady, Jill Jackson. I don't know if you ever heard about her, but mm-hmm. She used to do a radio show. And again, one of those early years, probably before I was 10, and my Aunt Adelaide and I were having dinner, and I think my parents were with us too that night, but she stuck me at Jill's table, and Jill stuck a microphone, and I didn't say a word. I was so terrified.
Well, I'm glad you got over that.
Yes, I did. But boy, for a little kid and a microphone, and it was a terrifying experience for me, but it's a memory I still have and I think about often.
Well, since you brought up Aunt Adelaide again, I'd be remiss without asking you for the ages to tell us the magical high school date that Aunt Adelaide helped arrange here at Brennan's for you.
Yeah, that was quite a night. My aunt had a very close friend, and they were trying to get me to date and get to know this lady's niece. And so it was two aunts helping their nephew and their niece get together, and we had a wonderful dinner. And after dinner, they got us up, and they took us to the front door and walked us outside of the street, and there was a carriage. And there was a bottle of champagne, and they told the driver, don't come back until the bottle's empty. And so we rode around the corner and had a wonderful, magical evening.
That's a magical high school date.
It is, you know, and probably, you know, we were underage too, as I recall. But, you know, that's New Orleans, and nothing ever came of it. We had a wonderful time. We still see each other every once in a while, and it's a great memory.
Ralph Brennan of the Ralph Brennan Restaurant Group. While it's well known that Brennan's is the original home of Bananas Foster, did you also know that it's home to a bevy of tiny turtles? We'll tell you all about it when Louisiana Eats returns in just a moment. Stay tuned. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Rouse's Markets, from Camellia Brand, Beans Done Right, a New Orleans tradition since 1923, and also from Ralph Brennan's Redfish Grill. From Dock to Pot, offering 9 varieties of fresh Gulf fish daily. Lunch, dinner, and private events at 115 Bourbon Street in the French Quarter. Are you podcasting Louisiana Eats yet? If not, it's time to subscribe. We've launched a new podcast series, Louisiana Eats Quick Bites. Quick Bites combine previously unaired interviews with lots of info and recipes, too. Our most recent podcast takes you behind the scenes at Elmer's Chocolate in Ponchatoula to learn how they roll back time, handcrafting heavenly hash, gold bricks, and pecan eggs, just as they've done for generations. You don't want to miss this, so subscribe today on our podcast page at poppytooker.com. That way, you won't miss a single serving of our broadcast or our new Quick Bites podcast. And now, back to Louisiana Eats. Like the city itself, all New Orleans restaurants have their own share of legend and lore. And Brennan's is no exception. But one thing that does make the venerable French Quarter restaurant exceptional are the residents in the courtyard fountain. These tiny terrapins are so beloved that now they have their very own parade and a children's book as well. We sat down with author Simone Rathe to hear how she was inspired to tell their whimsical tale.
It all started when they discovered and were doing a walkthrough. They were like, did someone said, do you know that there's turtles here in this pond? And they're like, what are we going to do with them? And Haley Bitterman, the corporate chef, said, I'll take care of them during the whole renovation. She had several little baby pools in her backyard. She lives in Algiers, fed them very well. Shrimp once a week, carrots and everything. They eat very, they're dining at Brennan's in a way. And then we had to celebrate the return of the turtles, and we had to bring it in a big way. So we had a turtle parade. It was fabulous. We had all of the associates of Brennan's, whoever decided to be able to make a float, they had to customize it, do it themselves for whatever the theme of that turtle was. And I will say Charlee Williamson is the one that named the turtles after the mother sauces. And
brilliant.
And the secondary sauces, which are Louisiana sauces. So it was brilliant. So we have 9 women turtles and 1 male turtle. And that male turtle is called Cocktail.
For those who may not know who the mothers and others are, those famous sauces, would you walk me through the turtles and introduce me to them?
Absolutely. Well, you have bechamel. So bechamel is pretty much a foundation for so many sauces. So, of course, she would have to be called La Grand-Mère. And so then you have velouté, which velouté is, it's such a velvety type of sauce, so we called it the green velvet. And then tomate, it's a orange, reddish color.
Tomato sauce.
So tomato sauce, so it's a blushing bell. And hollandaise, which you can't get enough. I'm going to have to find out how many gallons or something, whatever, how many eggs they make with hollandaise there at Brennan's.
Oh, I can't even imagine.
I can't imagine.
That's full.
So that is the sauce. And so she's the golden gal we've given her. And Espanol, it's that sort of a little spice to that sauce. So she is called the sassy sister. Then you go into the others, which everybody knows the remoulade. And remoulade has a great spice to it, too. So it's the spice girl. And because it sings when you eat it. And then the ravigote, we always love that wonderful ravigote. So we call her the Louisiana Dom. Bordelaise, that's a heavy, sturdy sauce. So it has to be the Duchess. And then cocktail, all you can say is, it's a boy.
It's a boy.
And then the mignonette, a little, you know, has a vinegary kind of. So,
oh, yes.
So that turtle's going to be a little persnickety, don't you think?
I do. So tell me, how did this book come about?
Well, we wanted to honor the turtles. We are all sitting around and thinking, Ralph and that, and I said, you know, it's the 300th anniversary. Turtles have been around for centuries. These turtles have probably been through some of our very main points in history of New Orleans.
So, and why, their ancestors were certainly here.
For sure. So, well, we know they had to have greeted, you know, Jean Lafitte and Bienville. So we said we should honor them and who they are. So we walked in this book is walking through key points in history of New Orleans and then bringing them to where they live now is Brennan's and their lifestyle at Brennan's and how they sit with the guests at Brennan's and they know how to cook and dine and serve. And so,
but the illustrations are so beautiful. Tell me about your co-author and illustrator.
That's Tanya Lee, and she has Tanya Lee Illustrations. She's been working with me as the editor. She used to be an editor at the Smithsonian, and really primarily she's an illustrator, and she's illustrated for Asprey. She illustrates calligraphy. She does wedding invitations. She's incredible. So I said, let's do this together.
I was there the day of that very first parade, and it was so adorable, and it was so much fun. But I think my very favorite part was when the turtles got released back into their fountain for the first time, and Monsignor Nalty was there, who blessed them, and he said the funniest thing. He said that he had passed many a blessing over a bowl of turtle soup, but that these were the first actual turtles that he had blessed.
So, and they were pardoned, too.
Yes, they're never going to end up in a bowl of turtle soup.
No, but, you know, it really is a family affair, and it really, I think, expresses on a serious note just what it is like at Brennan's. It's about a family experience when you're there. So bringing it out there and having everyone be a part, I think it's a charming way to do it.
Simone Rathley, author of A Topsy-Turvy History of New Orleans and 10 Tiny Turtles.
Me and you and me, no matter how they toss the dice, it had to be the only one for me is you and you for me. So happy together. So happy together. And how is the weather? So happy together.
I'm Damian Mogavero. I am the author of The Underground Culinary Tour and founder of Avero.
Author and entrepreneur Damian Mogavero has two major passions. One is for data analytics. The other is for the hospitality industry.
I fell in love with the restaurant business at age 16. I was a busboy in Cherry Hill, New Jersey at the Hyatt Hotel and learned one very important lesson. The general manager said to me, if you want to be successful in this business, you need to do one thing. That is exceed guest expectations. And that's something that I've lived my life, you know, with as simple, yet sometimes it can be challenging, you know, in this industry.
While it may seem like the unsentimental world of statistics are at odds with the romance of dining culture, Damian has been able to use his passion to transform the way restaurants conduct their business.
I was a frustrated restaurateur. I would ask my chefs and managers very simple questions like, who are your top and bottom servers? Why did your food costs go up? Why did your labor costs go up? And they gave me blank stares and wrong answers. And all the while, they would spend half their time in the back office as opposed to being in the kitchen making great food or on the floor providing great service. And I asked myself, is it just this restaurant group or is it the industry? And it turned out it was both. So what I wanted to do is really solve that problem. And so I brought together a chef, a sommelier, and a restaurant manager with three techies. And together, we created Avero and out of my studio apartment, grew Avero with a great team. And now Avero is 10,000 restaurants in 70 countries. And it's a software as a service that's used by many of the top restaurants in the industry.
Many of the biggest names in hospitality, such as Danny Meyer and Ralph Brennan, are fans. Damian's new book, The Underground Culinary Tour, explains how restaurants are using his data analysis software to modernize the industry.
The Underground Culinary Tour is the backstory of how our dining experience is being transformed by two big things. First, embracing data and technology. And second, it's the adaptation of trends from the foodie generation. The restaurateurs doing these two things, I call them the New Guard Restaurateur. And this book is really about the magic behind the scenes that makes this all possible. And one of the missing ingredients, an invisible ingredient, is data.
How did you come up with the concept of leading the Underground Culinary Tour? Because, by the way, anybody who thinks, oh, that sounds like a great idea, unless you're the CEO of a large company, you're not likely to come along on the bus, are you?
Well, the Underground Culinary Tour, the book, gets its name from a Underground Culinary Tour that I've hosted with Alice Elliott, a dear friend of mine. And it's essentially, it's 15 stops in 25 hours. And I use New York City as a restaurant laboratory to give restaurant leaders a glimpse of the future. And what I mean by that is trends that used to go from a place like a New York or a San Francisco or Chicago might take 20 years to get to the rest of the country. But because of technology, social media, foodie cable TV, these trends are now appearing in 6 to 12 months. And that's one of the primary reasons why I started the Underground Culinary Tour, and that's why the book gets its name.
Okay, let me ask you some of the most confounding words I found in the book. What are sabermetrics?
Yes, so the Underground Culinary Tour, think of it as like Moneyball for restaurants. So in the movie Moneyball, it's based upon the book by Michael Lewis. In there, Billy Beane was the general manager of the Oakland A's, and he used scarce resources to really compete against teams that had far greater resources like the New York Yankees. And so the parallel is in the Underground Culinary Tour, it's really Moneyball for restaurants. So instead of a baseball card, which would have runs batted in or on base percentage or home runs, the Avero scorecard actually has, well, how often did a server sell appetizers or desserts or bottle of wine or their table turn time? All of these are critical metrics for managers to better train and target, really mentoring to build confidence so they can deliver a magical experience.
When I read your chapter about theft and loss prevention, now I assumed that restaurants went to a system where the only way the servers were getting food out of the kitchen was by using the point of sale tools that come built in with the cash registers and everything. But you name many, many, many ways that they can circumvent that and steal from the restaurant owner.
Look, theft is an issue with every major industry. And restaurants are no exception to the rule. And the best way to explain the algorithm that we developed is the movie Catch Me If You Can. And in that movie, Leonardo DiCaprio's character is the thief. And it's always three steps ahead of Tom Hanks's character, the FBI director. And so think of this algorithm at Avero that we developed as replacing the Tom Hanks character. And the thing that an algorithm can do that a human cannot is you can go through hundreds of thousands of transactions in seconds. And the algorithm actually steered me towards a particular restaurant, a particular server, and with a colleague had a great lunch, and which included a Diet Pepsi. When they paid the bill, it turned out that they said the Diet Pepsi was voided out. Meanwhile, I saw my colleague drink the Diet Pepsi, and they also applied an obscure discount as well. So all in all, it was like $6 that didn't end up in the restaurant's bank account. It ended up in the server's bank account. And so one of the things that we see is this idea of micro theft. And it's really manipulating the point of sale for smaller amounts of transactions at higher frequencies. And so that $6 may not seem a lot, but if you look at the data, it was like $5,000 a year. And that is one of the beautiful things about technology is that you can really develop an algorithm that can identify this suspicious behavior.
And so we've name dropped these very high-end, glitzy names, but you have also worked with CEOs from Cinnabon and other organizations people may regard as sort of pedestrian.
Well, let me tell you, we are in New Orleans. So imagine we are having brunch at Brennan's, right in the French Quarter at Royal Street. And imagine, you know, it's a beautiful day in the courtyard, and the server, you know, guides us to egg sardou, a Cajun, you know, Bloody Mary, and bananas Foster, a dish that they invented. And we have a memorable experience. But what people don't see is this 70-year-old institution is using data and understanding the patterns to make sure that all the servers are trained to be able to deliver that experience and make sure the kitchen doesn't run out of the ingredients. And that's something that, since we're in New Orleans, I can't say enough about, you know, Ralph Brennan and his team, you know, at Brennan's, and how they are a new guard restaurateur. You know, even though they're 70, you know, year institution, they continually to innovate. And that's one of the real main messages in the book, is when you embrace data and you constantly evolve, they're the two things about being a new guard restaurateur.
Explain to us a little bit about how the Ralph Brennan Group came to adopt the data and the technology in order to survive.
You know, they have a great tradition in New Orleans of having phenomenal restaurants, and they wanted to expand to California. And one of the things when they embraced Avero is they were able to see trends that were happening. You know, look, I mean, that market in Disneyland is very different and very far away. And so it's a great lesson for anyone who's expanding out of their home market. The data actually showed that there was really different types of people, you know, coming in, what they were demanding, the price points, how to schedule labor. The data helped them figure out, well, maybe I need to evolve the menu a little bit and not be as, you know, exact same as
yes.
New Orleans. And I just love that, you know, part of the story, because it's, you know, using data to really help when you're growing outside of your home market.
During the time of what I refer to as the time of terrible troubles, our horrible, awful time in 2005 with Katrina, if it hadn't been for your data helping to turn around Ralph's Jazz Kitchen in Anaheim, which frankly, the way it read to me, he might have like pulled up roots and abandoned ship without the assistance of your data collection. That business kept the businesses here in New Orleans running through our time of terrible troubles.
You know, when I interviewed Ralph Brennan and Charlee Williamson, it made me tingle, you know, hearing how data can really change people's lives. And that's really, you know, the spirit of this book. It's not just about numbers. It's really about people and creativity. And I think how the Brennans used the data to really really change their business and really help each other's businesses and markets, which really enabled him to have more resources post-Katrina. I just loved the ability and opportunity to really tell that story.
Well, any time that you have some sort of great technology breakthrough that involves my favorite world, the hospitality world, give me a ring, would you?
Absolutely. And thanks for the cocktail.
Thank you. Damian Mogavero, founder of Avero and author of the Underground Culinary Tour. How, why, and by whom was that famous flaming dessert, Bananas Foster, invented? Stay tuned, and we'll answer that question when we come right back. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, and from French Market Coffee. French Market Coffee's premium blended beans are locally roasted in small batches, creating a coffee that can only be called New Orleans Bold. This week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. How, why, and by whom was that famous flaming dessert, Bananas Foster, invented? Bananas Foster was created in 1951 at Owen Brennan's original restaurant, the Vieux Carré. Owen challenged his baby sister Ella to come up with a dessert featuring bananas for a special party honoring Richard Foster, who was then head of the New Orleans Crime Commission. Owen served on the dock board, and at that time, South American bananas were flooding the port of New Orleans. Inspired by the caramelized bananas their mother often served for breakfast, Ella upped the ante by flaming the bananas as they sautéed, creating a dramatic dish whose popularity continues to grow today. When she served the bananas over vanilla ice cream for her brother to try, he asked why she had to ruin the dessert with the ice cream. I think it's a particular note that today, Bananas Foster outranks Cherry's Jubilee as the most famous flaming dessert in the world. Cherry's Jubilee was invented in 1897 on the occasion of Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee by the famous French chef Escoffier. Besting that distinction is quite an honor for the humble banana. I'm Poppy Tooker, and Bananas Foster is real Louisiana Eats.
Hi, my name is Charlee Williamson, and I'm the Executive Vice President of the Ralph Brennan Restaurant Group.
Embarking on her career with the Ralph Brennan Group directly out of college, Charlee Williamson began as a marketing executive, but soon found her way to the top. In her current position as executive VP, Charlee oversaw the restaurant group's move towards a more analytical approach to success in the dining room. After a fortuitous meeting with Damian Mogavero at a national restaurant show, the Ralph Brennan Group rolled out his software in their California location. That success led them to implement it throughout Ralph's entire restaurant group. We sat down to talk with Charlee about exactly what the benefits of Damian's analytics are. Charlee, I've known you a long time, but I had no idea about the depth and breadth of your restaurant operating knowledge, really, until I read Damian's book. And you all had a full chapter in there, Ralph Brennan and you and all the many things that have happened in your association with Damian. Tell me how you came to meet him.
Damian is one of the brightest, most energetic champions of our industry. And we actually met Damian at the National Restaurant Association show on the show floor, where he was marketing his product, Avero Slingshot, which essentially slings the data from the point of sales systems, which you can find in any restaurant, but it slings every keystroke that goes into that system into a cloud, which then you're able to access via the internet.
Now, everybody is familiar with the POS system. This software, how did it differentiate itself? What did it do for you that the other software didn't?
Well, we adopted this software in 2003, and we started using it at Ralph Brennan's restaurant, Jazz Kitchen, in Southern California. It is a 450-seat restaurant spread out over three stories, and it's at the Disneyland Resort in California. It's sandwiched between the two theme parks and three hotels, and we deliver on New Orleans' dual legacies of food and music. And we have been there for 17 years. It's a very successful today operation. But in the early days, it was very scary to be operating 1,800 miles away from New Orleans. Doing business in California is very different than doing business in New Orleans. So the business model is different. The clientele is different. And what we needed at that time was some quantitative data to be able to really understand what was going on in the restaurant when we couldn't be there every night. And so what Damian's software allowed us to do was to look at the restaurant operations from afar and have what was going on not filtered through any human beings, right? You ask the chef, any chef, how did something sell? And they're going to say it sold great.
Sold great.
Sold
Everybody
great.
Loved
People
it.
People loved it. I'm getting great feedback. But when you actually have access to numbers and are able to pull data, you can see you sold five last night. Now, if you only sold 20 dinners last night, five would be 25% of your sales, and that would be amazing. But very often, what feels like a lot isn't a lot to the operation. And so what Damian's software allowed us to do was really, from a quantitative perspective, understand what was selling, when it was selling, how our service staff was doing, who was selling what day parts were most successful, what sold well on, say, a Tuesday versus a Wednesday. And so it really just, for the first time, enabled that to happen automatically, where you weren't taking a piece of paper and a pencil and figuring it out yourself.
How did it change the front and back of the house?
Right. Well, you know, sometimes there's this effect where once people know somebody is looking, behavior can change just on that alone. So it became pretty apparent to the operation in California that the corporate office was watching. But more so, it's creating a culture around that says, we're not watching to try to catch you doing something wrong. We're watching you so that we can help you, so that we can support you, so that we can figure out whatever problem there is together. And once that trust was created between operations and New Orleans, what we call corporate New Orleans, we were able to put on the table what our issues were, decide how we were going to solve them, and move forward. But again, what the software did was it provided quantitative information, nothing filtered through human beings. Restaurants run by gut often, and that's part of the beauty of them is, and the inspiration is that they're not so micromanaged and so corporate. In fact, a lot of people don't want to work in a very corporate environment. But at the end of the day, this business operates on such slim margins. And, you know, what we have to realize is that in our restaurants, we have hundreds of employees. And the staff that's in these restaurants, they're putting food on their table, they're paying for their mortgage or their rent. They're sending their children to school. And so decisions are very important. It's, you know, lots of people's livelihoods are attached to it, not to mention the happiness of the guests that we serve and the reputation of the city and all of that good stuff. And so while the data is very unsexy in our industry, you know, the chefs had their moment, the maitre d's had their moment, I don't think the data people, the analysts, are really ever going to have their moment, and that's okay. But we have to respect the data-based business decisions that help operations make smart decisions the first time.
For instance, what did you learn from the server's scorecard?
Right. So the server scorecard is this amazing tool where you're able to actually look at every server in your lineup and understand what they do well and what their opportunities are. So you're, what you're able to do is filter out automatically the different variables that would make it an apples to oranges comparison. So here's an example. If all my shifts are at lunch and all your shifts are at dinner, your check average is going to be higher than mine because people drink more at dinner than they do at lunch and a lot of other reasons. So Damian software, without any manual manipulation, allows you to segment those variables and then run reporting so that when you're really looking at servers and what their strengths and opportunities are, you're measuring the right variables. And then you're able to do one-on-one coaching and counseling and saying, you know what, your wine sales are $5 behind your peers. Do you think it's, could it be, are you having trouble with the wine knowledge? Are you afraid to offer or are you afraid to open a bottle of wine so you don't want to sell it?
That's been an issue for you all before. Somebody
that's right.
Who wouldn't admit they didn't know how to open a bottle of wine.
That's right.
That's very stressful for a server.
That's right. And so while, yes, that can be uncovered just by visual observation in the dining room by a manager in a very busy house like Jazz Kitchen, you might not surface that. So really what this data provides us with is the ability to just ask questions. And then you go to the operations team and you say, why? And then you go from there to figure out the solution.
I would suspect that many future employees or newcomers into this arena might regard this as a little bit of Big Brother looking mm-hmm. over your shoulder. How do you get it across to them that this is something that's designed to help everybody, including them?
That's right. Well, the most important thing you can do is show service staff what a raise in the average check means to them. And, you know, they're still in restaurants today, you know, a tip model. And so if your check average goes up, then your tips go up as well. And if we can make that connection with the servers, if we can translate the math, then we can show them how it affects their pocketbook. So that's very effective. The other thing that it allows is a little friendly and healthy competition. Mm-hmm. You know, if you were running a contest to see who could sell the most bottled waters tonight, and you post those results on the office door, you know, people want to win. They want to be competitive and show that they're performing at the top of their game. So that helps too.
Well, Charlee, I am so grateful for you giving us this glimpse behind the scenes at the big operation that the Ralph Brennan restaurants are. You are one number cruncher, girl.
Well, it's all about making people happy. Thank you very much.
Charlee Williamson, Executive Vice President of the Ralph Brennan Restaurant Group. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Have you missed an episode of Louisiana Eats? Hear today's show or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. If you're not podcasting yet, it's time to subscribe. We've launched a new exclusive podcast series, Louisiana Eats Quick Bites. The podcast includes sneak previews of material that hasn't hit the airwaves yet, as well as exclusive full-length interviews never heard on the show before, well-seasoned with lots of food history and recipes, too. Visit our podcast page at poppytooker.com so you won't miss a single serving of our broadcast or our new podcast. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, French Market Coffee, Camellia Beans, and Rouse's Markets. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau, and from Tableau, brunch and dinner daily with outdoor balcony dining overlooking Jackson Square. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner, Sarah Holtz, and Reggie Morris. And to our business manager and social media maven, Maddie Mulladew. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studios at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. Don't forget to find our recipes and see what we're up to at poppytooker.com. You can check us out on Instagram and Facebook, too. Louisiana Eats is a production of Poppy Tooker Broadcasting.